All right, we're ready for our 23rd read aloud for Harry Potter. We're on chapter 10, called Halloween. Harry just received his broomstick, and it's the latest and greatest model of that. So it says, it's true, Harry chortled as they reached the top of the marble staircase. If he hadn't stolen Neville's Rememberall, I wouldn't be on the team. So I suppose you think that's a reward for breaking rules, came an angry voice from just behind them. Hermione was stomping up the stairs, looking disapprovingly at the package in Harry's hands. I thought you weren't speaking to us, said Harry. Yes, don't stop now, said Ron. It's doing us so much good. Hermione marched away with her nose in the air. Harry had a lot of trouble keeping his mind on his lessons that day. It kept wandering up to the dormitory where his new broomstick was lying under his bed, or straying off to the Quidditch field where he'd be learning to play that night. He bolted his dinner that evening without noticing what he was eating, and then rushed upstairs with Ron to unwrap the Nimbus 2000 at last. Wow, Ron sighed as the broomstick rolled into Harry's bedspread. Even Harry, who knew nothing about the different brooms, thought it looked wonderful, sleek and shiny with a mahogany handle. It had a long tail of neat straight twigs and a Nimbus 2000 written in gold near the top. As 7 o'clock drew nearer, Harry left the castle and set off in the dust toward the Quidditch field. He'd never been inside the stadium before. Hundreds of seats were raised in stands around the field so that the spectators were high enough to see what was going on. At either end of the field, there were three golden poles with hoops on the end. They reminded Harry of the little plastic sticks Muggles' children blew bubbles through, except that they were 50 feet high. Too eager to fly again to wait for wood, Harry mounted his broomstick and kicked off from the ground. What a feeling. He swooped in and out of the goalpost and then sped up and down the field. The Nimbus 2000 turned wherever he wanted at his lightest touch. Hey, Potter, come down! Oliver Wood had arrived. He was carrying a large wooden crate under his arm. Harry landed next to him. Very nice, said Wood, his eyes glinting. I see what McGonagall meant. You're really a natural. I'm just going to teach you the rules this evening, then you'll be joining team practice three times a week. He opened the crate inside, where four different sized balls. Right, said Wood. Now, Quidditch is easy enough to understand, even if it's not so too easy to play. There are seven players on each side. Three of them are called chasers. Three chasers, Harry repeated, as Wood took out a bright red ball about the size of a soccer ball. This ball is called the quaffle. This ball is called the quaffle, said Wood. The chasers throw the quaffle to each other and try to get it through one of the hoops to score a goal. 10 points every time the quaffle goes through one of the hoops. Follow me? The chasers throw the quaffle and put it through the hoops to score, Henry recited. So that's sort of like basketball on broomsticks with six hoops, isn't it? What's basketball? Asked Wood curiously. Never mind, said Harry quickly. Now, there's another player on each side who's called the keeper. I'm keeper for Gryffindor. I have to fly around our hoops and stop the other team from scoring. Three chasers, one keeper, said Harry, who was determined to remember it all. And they play with the quaffle. Okay, got that. So what are they for? He pointed at the three balls that were left inside the box. I'll show you now, said Wood. Take this. Excuse me. He handed Harry a small club, a bit like a short baseball bat. I'm going to show you what the bludgers do, Wood said. These two are bludgers. He showed Harry two identical balls, jet black and slightly smaller than the red quaffle. Harry noticed that they seemed to be straining to escape the straps holding them inside the box. Stand back, Wood warned Harry. He bent down and freed one of the bludgers. At once, the black ball rose high in the air and then pelted straight at Harry's face. Harry swung at it with the bat to stop it from breaking his nose and sent it zigzagging away into the air. It zoomed around their heads and then shot at Wood, who dived on top of it and managed to pin it to the ground. See? Wood panted, forcing the struggling bludger back into the crate and strapping it down safely. The bludgers rocket around trying to knock players off their brooms. That's why you have two beaters on each team. The Weasley twins are ours. It's their job to protect their side from the bludgers and try and knock them toward the other team. So, think you've got it all that? Three chasers. Try and score with the quaffle. The keeper guards the goalpost. The beaters keep the bludgers away from their teams. Harry reeled off. Very good, said Wood. Have the bludgers ever killed anyone? Harry asked, hoping he sounded offhanded. Never at Hogwarts. We've had a couple of broken jaws, but nothing worse than that. Now, the last member of the team is the Seeker. That's you. And you don't have to worry about the Quaffle or the bludgers, unless they crack my head open. Don't worry, the Weasleys are more than a match for the bludgers. I mean, they're like a pair of human bludgers themselves. Wood reached into the crate and took out the fourth and last ball. Compared with the Quaffle and the bludgers, it was tiny, about the size of a walnut. It was bright gold and had little fluttering silver rings. This, said Wood, is the Golden Snitch, and it's the most important ball of the lot. It's very hard to catch because it's so fast and difficult to see. It's the Seeker's job to catch it. You've got to weave in and out of the chasers, beaters, bludgers, and quaffle to get it before the other team's Seeker, because whichever Seeker catches the snitch wins his team an extra 150 points, so they nearly always win. That's why Seekers get fouled so much. A game of Quidditch only ends when the snitch is caught, so it can go on for ages. I think the record is 3 months. They had to keep bringing on substitutes so the players could get some sleep. Well, that's it. Any questions? Harry shook his head. He understood what he had to do, all right. It was doing it that was going to be the problem. We won't practice with the snitch yet, said Wood, carefully shutting it back inside the crate. It's too dark. We might lose it. Let's try you out with a few of these. He pulled a bag of ordinary golf balls out of his pocket, and a few minutes later, he and Harry were up in the air, Wood throwing the golf balls as hard as he could in every direction for Harry to catch. Harry didn't miss a single one, and Wood was delighted. After half an hour, night had already really fallen, and they couldn't carry on. That Quidditch couple have our name on it this year, said Wood happily as they trudged back up to the castle. I wouldn't be surprised if you turn out better than Charlie Weasley, and he could have played for England if he hadn't gone off chasing dragons. Perhaps it was because he was now so busy, what with Quidditch practice 3 evenings a week on top of all of his homework, but Harry could hardly believe it when he realized that he'd already been at Hogwarts 2 months. The castle felt more like home than Privet Drive ever had. His lessons, too, were becoming more and more interesting now that they had mastered the basics. On Halloween morning, they woke up to the delicious smell of baking pumpkin wafting through the corridors. Even better, Professor Flitwick announced in charms that he thought they were ready to start making objects fly, something they had all been dying to try since they'd seen him make Neville's toad zoom around the classroom. Professor Flitwick put the class into pairs to practice. Harry's partner was Seamus Finnegan, which was a relief because Neville had been trying to catch his eye. Ron, however, was to be working with Hermione Granger. It was hard to tell whether Ron or Hermione were angrier about this. She hadn't spoke to either of them since the day Harry's broomstick had arrived. Now don't forget that nice wrist movement we've been practicing, squeaked Professor Flitwick, perched on top of his pile of books as usual. Swish and flick, remember? Swish and flick. And saying the magic words properly is very important too. Never forget Wizard Baruffio, who says S instead of F and found himself on the floor with a buffalo on his chest. It was very difficult. Harry and Seamus swished and flicked, but the feather they were supposed to be sending skyward just lay on the desktop. Seamus got so impatient that he prodded it with his wand and set it to fire. Harry had to put it out with his hat. Ron at the next table wasn't having much more luck. Wingardium Leviosa, he shouted, waving his long arms like a windmill. You're saying it wrong, Harry heard Hermione snap. It's Wingardium Leviosa. Make the gar nice and long. You do it then if you're so clever, Ron snarled. Hermione rolled up the sleeves of her gown, flicked her wand, and said, Wingardium Leviosa. Their feather rose off the desk and hovered about 4 feet above their heads. Oh, well done, cried Professor Flitwick, clapping. Everyone see here? Miss Granger's done it. Ron was in a very bad mood by the end of the class. It's no wonder no one can stand her, he said to Harry as they pushed their way into the crowded corridors. She's a nightmare, honestly. Someone knocked into Harry as they hurried past him. It was Hermione. Harry caught a glimpse of her face and was startled to see that she was in tears. I think she heard you. So, said Ron, but he looked a bit uncomfortable too. She must have noticed she's not got no friends. Hermione didn't turn up for the next class and wasn't seen all afternoon. On their way down to the Great Hall for Halloween feast, Harry and Ron overheard Parvati Patel telling her friends, Lavender, that Hermione was crying in the girls' bathroom and wanted to be left alone. Ron looked still more awkward at this, but a moment later, they had entered the Great Hall where the Halloween decorations put Hermione out of their minds. 1,000 live bats fluttered from the walls and ceiling, while 1,000 more swooped over the tables in low black clouds, making the candles in the pumpkins stutter. The feast appeared suddenly on the golden plates as it had at the start of the term banquet. Harry was just helping himself to a baked potato when Professor Quirrell came sprinting into the hall, his turban askew and terror on his face. Everyone stared as he reached Professor Dumbledore's chair, slumped against the table, and gasped, "Troll! In the dungeons! Thought you ought to know!" He then sank to the floor in a dead faint. There was an uproar. It took several purple firecrackers exploding from the end of Professor Dumbledore's wand to bring silence. "Prefix!" he rumbled. "Lead your houses back to the dormitory immediately." Percy was in his element. "Follow me. Stick together, first years. No need to fear the troll if you follow my orders. Stay close behind me now. Make way first. First years come through. Excuse me, I'm a prefect." "How could a troll get in?" Harry asked as they climbed the stairs. "Don't ask me. They're supposed to be really stupid," said Ron. "Maybe Peas let it in for Halloween as a joke." They passed different groups of people hurrying in different directions. As they jostled their way through a crowd of confused Hufflepuffs, Harry suddenly grabbed Ron's arm. "I've just thought. Hermione, what about her? She doesn't know about the troll." Ron bit his lip. "Oh, all right," he snapped, "but Percy had better not see us." Ducking down, they joined the Hufflepuffs going the other way, slipped down a deserted side corridor, and hurried off toward the girls' bathroom. They had just turned the corner when they heard quick footsteps behind them. "Percy!" hissed Ron, pulling Harry behind a large stone griffin. Peering around it, however, they saw not Percy, but Snape. He crossed the corridor and disappeared from view. "What's he doing?" Harry whispered. "Why isn't he down in the dungeon with the rest of the teachers?" I don't know. We're going to stop there. We will start on Chapter 10, Halloween, at our next reading. So this ended 23, I believe. See you later.